Okay, so we are going whenever you're ready. Beethoven Pathetique, Sonata Opus 13.
Thank you. up the tremolos, but it felt so heavy for some reason. That actually, so I was struggling.
I think particularly with tremolos.
Oh.
I mean, basically with tremolos, you want to just keep them in the background more than anything. I mean, they're so easy to overpower. I didn't notice.
Right.
Well, maybe you were having trouble, but it wasn't very conspicuous. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
Well, I have a couple thoughts about the whole piece and stuff, and obviously the movements. But how do you think of this piece in terms of Beethoven's complete output and his, in the context of all the sonatas? Like, I think it's very interesting, this one specifically.
Well, it belongs to his early period.
Yeah.
Right? And
very early, it was 13, you know.
Is and it was such a hit, right?
Well, that's the danger of playing it. It's so popular.
Yeah. But it's also so amazing. I mean, every movement is so amazing. It's so dramatic. It's so communicative. I think that's the thing that that's what speaks to me, and that I think is the appeal of the sonata, is that it's so communicative. I mean, that opening is so what's the word? Kind of like not a recitative, but
well, it's or an overture. I mean, it's like it's that's where I was going actually. I mean, you have clues in the title, grand sonate pathétique. It's like already it's not just a piano sonata. It's obviously he's like, because I think with Beethoven the big thing that he did was transition from the classical period to the romantic era,
mm-hmm.
and he was always stretching form and conceiving of it in other ways. I mean, Haydn did it too, who was his teacher, but I think Beethoven took it a lot further. And I think for me this piece, even though it's so early, there are many elements of romanticism already in this early piece, and I think the sort of the introduction as sort of pillars throughout the movement,
mm-hmm.
That's a very new concept, I believe, or maybe it's been done once or twice in the past, but it's pretty unusual in sonata form,
mm-hmm.
and then
the pathétique aspect of it, the pathos.
Yeah. Right, which is, because it's going more toward the passion and the emotion and the deep feeling, whereas the classical period was much more kind of objective and sort of maintaining a veneer of order.
Yeah.
So, and I would say this piece, that's what it's sort of balancing, is it's very orderly in some ways, it's clear structure and everything, but
there are lots of extremes.
Yeah, exactly. You feel the interior life of Beethoven and you feel the emotional life of him very much. So I just wanted to say, like, that I think makes this piece significant.
Mm-hmm.
And the other big challenge, of course, is like it's famous for a reason, because it is so lovely and so, well, not lovely, but it's so gripping and
mm-hmm.
beautiful and sublime. But it gets overplayed, so you have to really believe in it if you're going to do it. So okay. So anyway, we can get into the first movement. I think.
Of the three movements, which movement do you find I should needs more attention? Just planning wise, it's useful to know.
I see little things in all of them, but I guess the third movement is freshest in my head.
Okay.
I just think, for me, I don't know if you agree with this, but for me the third movement is the most classical.
Yes, I agree with that.
Yeah, it feels like the other early sonatas.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas first and second, it's almost late Beethoven in moments, you know.
Yeah.
It has this profundity, it has this richness and lyricism. There's a lot of room to use pedal.
Mm-hmm.
I think the third movement is an exception, and it
mm-hmm.
should be Haydn-like.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought your tempo was a little fast.
Oh,
and
interesting.
A little,
okay.
I thought some of your chords in the left hand were too heavy.
Okay.
I would take a more Mozartian, Haydn classical touch where you almost do the, I forget the term for this, but when you're interpreting Mozart, if you have a quarter note chord, you generally play an eighth note with an eighth rest.
Uh-huh.
To sort of create the forte
okay.
piano character,
because right.
everything was shorter.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that's a little extreme here, but I don't think it's too far off. So I would, we'll work on it, but that's just my feeling, that I just wanted a little more clarity, a little less pedal in places.
Okay.
And the chords can be just a little shorter,
mm-hmm.
not necessarily lighter, because you do have some fire in moments, but it's very solid though. Like, it's not like there's much to fix technically at all. It's just a little bit of interpretive things. So,
mm-hmm.
Second movement was, I just have a one main comment on it, so
mm-hmm.
we can get to that. But let's. The main thing I have in the first movement to start anyway in the introduction,
mm-hmm.
I don't feel your tempo,
mm-hmm.
and I think in a slow tempo, you really have to be somewhat strict in order to hold it together. Like, I think he writes in all of the interest of the like the rhythmic interest you have toward the end. You have groups of six and seven, and then. Are those 128 notes? I'm not even sure, but
mm-hmm.
really, really fast groups of four.
Mm-hmm.
But in order to ground that, we need to feel a steady beat from the beginning. I felt like the beginning was just too rhetorical and free.
Okay.
And I think you should use the 16th notes from this part as your sort of
mm-hmm.
subdivision grounding point, because I think it really works if you just have that pulling you through all the way. It's just going to be a little tighter.
Okay.
And also, it's just something to keep you from getting too nervous, because you have something sort of going.
Right.
You have that. That's the idea. You don't have to agree, but let's just try it for now.
Okay.
So, play. Da ding ba da dum, from the E flat major. So, I can't sing it all today, but so come down and then grow. Don't swell too soon. Technically faster than those.
Right.
I know you slowed down. Okay.
I'm not gonna lie, that's a kind of I do it a bit spontaneous.
Yeah, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I kind of do like the da-da-da-da-da to set it up. I think maybe a little ritardano is appropriate there. But just try to be very clear. Don't rely on the pedal so much, because you don't need it as much.
Okay.
Actually, sorry, but you have a staccato there on that. So,
oh.
Bum, 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 T.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Actually, there too is staccato. I don't know if you want to be quite literal with it, or maybe it's just a departing of the key to get the octave,
right.
But it is written.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I should study the score again. So
well,
I've forgotten some of these
details. There are a lot of details. You also want to be really solid in the competition,
yeah.
So only change what you're able to. You have to be practical. It's
mm-hmm.
not like you played badly at all. It's just there's more that can be
mm-hmm.
mined, if you
yeah.
will. But yeah, that's just a little thing.
Okay.
Maybe right there. Try to make the next E flat come out of the one that preceded. So, but not. Don't accent. Yeah, careful. Because it's almost like If we're thinking that this is not a piano piece, what genre would this be? Because sometimes it's a quartet, sometimes it's an opera,
right.
sometimes it's symphony. What would you think?
Quartet.
Quartet?
Well, in many places, not.
Maybe
in
this seems bigger, though, to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, the third movement I could see as a quartet for
yeah.
sure, but this feels orchestral to me.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless, my point is here, I think of it as orchestral. You have a certain group of instruments here,
mm-hmm.
and then I think a sudden shift to full tutti maybe, or
mm-hmm.
just large scale brass or something.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can, cut with the pedal so that we have something piano
mm-hmm.
and almost a very dramatic pa-pum, pa-pum, suddenly,
okay.
because it's too elided,
okay.
it's too connected. And you have to go to piano again. Actually, the interesting thing here is do to si, not the inner voice,
oh, okay.
because you're really pounding the inner voice, but I think the more interesting thing is, I can take that. So.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yeah, but, don't So try once more, and just keep the chords very, very even. That was all pretty good. I just think here I would be very kind of, it's feeling more classical again here, I think. Mm-hmm. So I would use no pedal here.
Okay.
Just as clear as you can. It's important to feel the rests wherever he writes them. The music has breath to it. Half notes that you need to project, and then he writes staccato eighth notes every two beats, and so, or I guess every beat, but so it's almost the equivalent of that.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I think if you can take those a little more seriously, then you need to kind of really, if you're going to use pedal, you have to just sort of ping them a little bit more, you have to accent them somehow so that it's clear.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the contour goes, and even here. For me, this section, just the octave there, it's too much pedal. I would be a little more classical there,
okay,
for lack of a better word. But anyway, stay soft there longer. You can soft pedal.
Okay.
definitely rotation, yes, but try not to be flat fingered, but to grab that note in slow motion. That's right. With the fingertip, it's going to be a clearer, more bell-like, sharper sound. Baseline, I think, is really important, and I would do almost without pedals, so it's very clear. Could you try that? Just get into it somewhere.
No, but I've heard about, it's like about that dysfunctional.
Yeah, but it, composer essentially ripped this off. He has like a, it's a little bit like hip hop style,
mm-hmm.
but it's like. Can we do the ending? Let's go. Maybe same place and keep going. Sorry, yeah. The silence more than the resolution. I think if there's a more of a contrast between the dissonance and the consonance, it's going to be more compelling. In the same way, you really attack the first note. Da di da da. I think I would wait until the fourth sound.
Okay.
It was too sudden. Second movement,
mm-hmm.
I don't have much to say, it's really beautifully played. The main thing I thought actually with the main theme is you were most convincing here in the triplets for some reason. Do you know why?
Maybe because while the triplets make it so that the music is going faster.
Yeah,
well,
it moves
faster.
Forward better.
Yeah.
So my suggestion is to take a faster tempo. Because on the piano we can only sustain for so long, so we need to kind of move it forward. You can use what's the Bach quote that, or somebody said about Bach's playing, that his adagios were pretty close to his allegros, and his allegros were pretty close to his adagios. So,
I don't know that.
Yeah, it's somebody said that anyway, but I always use that as a bit of license when you have a tempo indication and it's not quite working. Maybe it just needs to flow forward, or maybe the allegro needs to come down a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Can we try that?
Yeah.
Just obsessed with that.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's pretty good, but just to remind you. Now, here, third movement, I think it's in really good shape, but like I said, I think it just needs to be a little classical, slightly more restrained. I mean, for competition, you don't want it to run away anyway, so if you think slightly conservative with the tempo, it's probably going to be about right with the nerves, you know. Just play a little bit. There are a few things, but... Just try it in slow motion.
Something like that. Maybe a little bit. I struggled
a little bit before.
But I just try not to do, which is what I used to do.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that. I would go dun dun dun,
bum, yeah.
Dun
dun. Like that?
Yeah, like actually accenting the F and then accenting the E flat. Because if you're halfway in between, it's like just trying to fit it in there, it's not going to be convincing.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know what you're doing,
okay.
Or know what you want, I guess is what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
And I would accent or to the four. So da 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 da. Fazioli's are notorious for this, at the bass being really overpowering sometimes.
Yeah.
I remember the Fazioli in the hall was that way. It was tough to control the bass. So anyway, the octave was kind of overpowering, and then we need the B natural more than the
thank you.
also easier to play a classical tempo.
Yeah, I mean, because...
It was too neurotic before, like da-da-da-da-da.
There is that, but I think it's less in the third movement, it's in the first movement for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I mean, you have other repertoire that's neurotic. You have Schumann,
right.
You have Prokofiev, moments in Prokofiev too, like, saved, and you want to show that you really understand the style and you can do Bach and classical repertoire really well with good taste. So don't, that's the danger. When you have virtuosic classical or Baroque music, the tendency is to go too far that way and then you lose your sense of style and restraint, I think. Not you, but just we all, you know, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So I think just reining it in a little bit, especially here. But yeah, just
well,
a little
this
bit.
This was definitely helpful. This was like the most neglected piece, for sure. So now
but
I feel like it's...
Yeah, you're ready. You're ready. Just add those little details, and maybe that'll hopefully inspire you a little bit more to just kind of get boiling again.
Yeah, on Wednesday I'm going to run it for Henry.
Perfect.
So, yeah, this is helpful. Because I want to, you know, play my best.
Of course, of course. Yeah, for the big teacher.
Yeah.
Awesome. Let me turn this off.
Okay, cool. Thank you so much. That was super helpful.